time to switch on the computer. And let's get computing!
If an artist really working to answer that question too, and like make this entire system more tangible and more digestible for people through art and how art communicates, and that's why it makes so much sense. Like that's why PFPs make a lot of sense. That's why crypto art makes sense. It's like these ways of attempting to communicate what this is all about.
I realized there are a bunch of other nerds around the world that I care about the intersection of art and tech too.
Test, 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 test. Hello, hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of The Dankness. I am one of your hosts, Dan Sickles.
I am Jason Bailey, a.k.a. Art Gnome, one of your other hosts.
And we are hosting some of the best minds in the cryptosphere for conversation about their work, their life, and digging into a bit more of the mythology surrounding the space.
Yeah, so Dan and I realized that a lot of times these artists and collectors and personalities in sort of the crypto art NFT space, we read kind of the same questions and the same answers from them in a lot of interviews and podcasts. And, you know, sometimes it feels like they always were just kind of famous and don't necessarily, it's like hard to relate sometimes. But having known a lot of them before the space blew up, we wanted to start a podcast where we intentionally try to get at who they are as humans, not just as sort of famous and accomplished, you know, artists in the space. So we're trying to sort of flesh out who they are by asking unusual questions and being a little bit more casual. And we've been having a ton of fun with it so far.
Yes, we have. I'm super, super stoked for today's episode, episode number 2. Today, we have in studio with us one Miss Sarah Zucker. I think I said that right. Did I say that right, Jason?
I think it's Zucker. I think, yeah, you've gone back and forth a few times, but I don't claim to be an expert, but I think it's, you know, Zucker.
Zucker. I'm probably going to mess it up regardless when we chat with her today. But yeah, Sarah's one of my favorite artists. So stoked to have her in the studio with us. Shall we get to it?
If you like that.
Yeah, let's do it.
Forget about it.
We give you the dankness.
Exactly. Cool. You guys are cool.
Club NFT is a free club for NFT collectors. We help collectors analyze their collection and keep it safe by creating local backups. And it's all free. Why not go to Club NFT today and analyze your collection and make sure that it's safe by creating a local backup? Your JPEGs will thank you.
All right. Welcome back to The Dankness. This is a segment that we call Show and Tell, where each of us chooses something either relevant to the cryptosphere or not to share about our past week. Jason, I will call on you this time. How about you go first and tell us what's up?
I got some shit that's dank.
Yeah, I think everybody has been talking about FTX collapse and SBF, Sam Bankman-Fried. You know,
and the IRS
and the IRS,
FBI,
the FBI, lots of acronyms out there. Yeah, I mean, I think from my perspective, it's put a little bit of a chill on the space. You know, I run a startup in the space and we're in the middle of fundraising. And I think a lot of people are kind of nervous or anxious about, like, how far is the FTX contagion going to reach? Is it going to, you know, like, are other companies going to go under? Or is, like, what's it going to do to the NFT space? And I personally lost about $4,000 in BlockFi, which was, you know, part of sort of the far-reaching tendrils of the FTX collapse. You know, there's sort of dominoes there. But I consider myself lucky. And look, the message there, from my perspective, is, like, shame on me, right? Not your keys, not your wallet. Anyone who's been in crypto for a little while, you know, should know that. And, like, the extension to that, you know, the FTX had an NFT platform as well. And their NFT platform, much like I'm always...
Oh, I see where you're going, Bailey.
Much like I'm always preaching, right? Like, do not, you know, buy NFTs that put the art and the metadata on private servers, because what happens? Well, we actually now have seen a recent example. When the FTX NFT platform went down, all the images associated broke, right, with those NFTs, because, like, there was no way for collectors to actually back them up. So another acronym, IPFS, right? You want to buy NFTs that actually use IPFS instead of private servers, so you, the collector, can back them up, right? So I have not...
Preach.
Preach. I'm preaching, right? I mean...
Preach, Bailey.
You have to understand, Dan, I'm a year into, like, telling people this, and everyone's like... Marketplaces are never gonna go under. NFTs are so strong. You're like, you know, Chicken
Little. This is
forever,
man.
The sky is falling. You know, you're like yelling, the sky is falling, and freaking people out, right? And now I'm like, see, like, marketplaces do collapse, and like, if they don't build their NFTs correctly, it's like, it's bad news, right? But I will say, like, I'm not freaked out. Like, I'm still buying and collecting NFTs. Of course, ones that can be backed up, you know, not just or certainly not the ones that use private servers. And I'm still, you know, still carry crypto. But, like, this was sort of a wake-up call or lesson, I think, for a lot of folks. I don't know. Like, how have you been impacted at all, Dan, or heard any stories, you know, as a result of FTX?
Fortunately, like, I wasn't directly impacted in the FTX implosion. And it was, I mean, it was going to be sort of my show and tell bit for today as well. So glad you brought it up. You know, I think that there's a lot to, obviously there's a lot to talk about here. I think for me, like, it really sort of comes again to this notion that, like, no one man should have all that power. Such a loaded That's quote right, to throw baby. In here today, but it's true, right? It's just sort of like this is a distributed system that we're building. There are actual tools in place to protect you from actually, like, losing your currency, losing your NFTs in this way. Not only by using something like a cold wallet, but by also backing them up, going to clubnft.com and doing so. But, like, this system is built in a way to actually to sort of counteract this idea that somebody can steal your things from you without you knowing, in, like, sort of these, like, obtuse sort of traditional financial, you know, maneuvers that sort of laymen like myself will never ever completely understand, right? And even in this fallout now, like, you sort of see how he kind of talks around answering any direct questions as to what happened, because I think that, to me, that's something that a lot of people from traditional finance world are just very used to, right?
That?
Like, oh, well, this is just so complicated that you just can't actually understand what went down. And I think that, like, the most important thing to take away from it is, again, not your keys, not your coin, right? There are ways that you can prevent your things being taken in the crypto sphere, and you should absolutely be using a cold wallet. I've talked to my friends at a few companies, and, like, you know, I guess the silver lining here is that this sort of implosion has been a boon for those cold wallet companies. You know, people are, like, actually very, they're more invested than ever in figuring out how to back themselves up. And I do think that there is something positive in that. It's unfortunate that, like, people sort of arrive at this place, you know, by virtue of sort of these situations occurring, but, you know, glad people are learning more about what they can do to protect themselves from you know, losing their hard-earned NFTs, crypto, whatever it is.
Yeah, for sure, not a good look for crypto, right? Like, I sort of sarcastically tweeted when I first, you know, heard about it. I'm like, oh, I think I understand decentralization now. We all take all our money and put it in one spot under the authority of a single person who can, like, destroy us all, you know, which is, like, you know, I mean, you know, it certainly looks less decentralized when so many, you know, institutions and entities can collapse all because of one person. It actually looks less decentralized than traditional finance in a way, right? But maybe this is the wake-up call. And, you know, my OG friends in the space that have been in crypto for 5-10 years or whatever, like, those were the folks that weren't impacted, right? Because they know better, and they kind of keep their own keys and, you know, have everything set up properly. And to your point, Dan, for the rest of us, I think it's a wake-up call, you know? We learn, we move on, and we continue to build.
with that, a pre-roll.
In a world where digital art has been historically undervalued, one film is here to set the record straight. Featuring over 100 artists, collectors, and developers, each an important voice in the NFT community, partially funded with the cutest NFT project you've ever seen, Depop Studios presents I'm New Here. Learn more and mint your newbie today at newhere.xyz.
And welcome back to the Dankness. For today's episode, we have a very, very special guest. Sarah Zucker is in our studio. Sarah Zucker, ladies and gentlemen, is an artist and a writer based in Los Angeles. Her work merges humor, myth, and mysticism with the interplay of cutting-edge and obsolete technologies. She's known for mixing digital and physical video techniques with the analog medium of VHS. She's been editioning her work as NFTs on the blockchain since April 2019. Her work was part of Natively Digital, the first curated NFT sale at Sotheby's, and Crypto OGs, the pioneers of NFT art, at Bonhams. In 2022, she was named the inaugural. She was named to the inaugural NFT 100 list by NFT Now as one of the top artists working with NFTs. She's participating in Peer-to-Peer, which is the first survey of leading artists engaging with the blockchain, presented at an American museum. We're going to talk a bit more about this later in the episode. Her GIFs have over 6.9 billion views on Giphy. And one of my favorite tidbits about Sarah is that she is a Jeopardy champion, also something that we will probably touch on in our conversation with her today. Personally, Sarah is one of my favorite artists working today, full stop. Her work is irresistibly magnetizing. It draws us in like moths to a VHS flame. The way that she articulates the relevance and auratic potential for the movement and genre is very rare. And anybody interested in this space, as an artist, as a collector, as an admirer, you should absolutely, absolutely spend some time listening to the various talks and lectures and interviews that she's given, because they are absolutely spectacular. Some particular works of hers that I love, Everything's Different Now, The Light Witch, Licky Loaf, It's the Witch, Not the Wand, and The Cassandra Complex, of which there are so many others that, again, I encourage you to check out. I've personally been fortunate enough to collect some of her work on Tezos. She mints on various blockchains as well, something that we can talk about. But you can find more about Sarah and her work on her website at sarahzucker.com, sarahzucker.com, and at The Sarah Show on all the socials. So, so amped to have her today and to spend some time chatting with her. But before that, Art Gnome, I mean, you and Sarah go way back. I would love to hear how you became friends, how you met each other.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think we've known each other for like 4 years now, maybe. You know, I had been stalking Sarah and her work on Super Rare for a while, and wasn't aware of sort of her success on Giphy, and you know, and how much she had accomplished before sort of the crypto art space. I just saw this person whose work stood out from everybody else's work. So she puts herself into the work, and there's like these really trippy like videos early on of her kind of coming in and out of the frame. And then, you know, this old school sort of VHS style work. And she has sort of two of my favorite qualities, which are hard to find in one person. She's super smart, and she's super weird in like the best possible way, right?
So true, so true.
So, and you just don't get that very often in the same person. So what happened, like the being aware of Sarah for a while, what happened that actually led to us getting to know each other, I had made maybe my first big sale on a secondary market as a collector of an NFT. And at the time, I was conflicted because I'm like, I don't even know that I want to sell anything. But there weren't really any secondary sales happening. And I felt like someone has to show that like there's actually potential for a secondary sale. But I immediately committed to spending like, you know, the majority of what I made on other artists. And I knew I wanted as much of Sarah's work as I could get. So I kind of remember Sarah can help me, you know, if this is accurate or not. But I think like the day after I made the sale, I bought like four or five works. And I basically told everybody on Twitter, I was like, you guys are all losers. This work is great. It's been there and it's been available and no one picked it up. And now that I have money, like, because there was a lot of like questionable work. I mean, I feel like we're honest on this podcast, so I can just say what I really think. There was a lot of work selling that I was just like, man, I don't think that's very good, right? Oh, but here's Sarah's work kind of just sitting there. There were a few collectors there before me, but I was just like, I am scooping it all up and it's really good and you missed out, right? Is kind of, and since then, you know, I we've met only once, believe it or not, in I think it was NFT in America or something like that in LA in real life, but have talked a bunch. And I really think of her as sort of like my crypto art sister in a weird way, which hopefully she can say whether or not that's weird or not. But I think we vibe on a lot of different levels. So yeah, just has been, you know, I've seen a lot of people come up in the last 4 or 5 years in this space as the community's grown, and I've seen a lot of people become successful, but few do I root harder for and get more excited about than seeing opportunities open up for Sarah. You know, maybe we can come back to it and talk about it at a certain point, but I also think, you know, when I see opportunities or feel ardent about a cause, I often reach out to Sarah too. So there was a work of hers that I wanted to sell, an important work to me from my collection, to help support women's reproductive rights. And I thought it can't just be any work. It has to be like one of my absolute favorite works, right? So I reached out to Sarah and said, hey, like, I don't want to bring like unnecessary like attention to you in ways that you're not comfortable with, but like, I'm really pissed off about this. And I feel like if I don't say anything, then I'm not going to feel good about it, you know? And we kind of teamed up for that too. So yeah, I mean, just someone I admire and respect and I'm glad to call a friend.
How are you, Sarah?
I mean, I'm positively glowing over here. You guys are so nice to me. And yeah, Jason, I mean, of course, you're my crypto art brother. I mean, we've the level of sheer psychedelic weirdness that we've seen together, you know, I'm really grateful. You're one
trippy.
Of the people that one of the people in this space that you help orient me, you know, like sometimes you can feel really lost at sea. And there's really a very short list of people that I kind of like will check in with and like, you know, see what you've got going on. Look at your Twitter feed because it like it helps me kind of get on back on my feet and be like, no, this is OK. We've got this. Like the good people are still here doing good things. Right. And it's easy to forget that with the deluge of scammy bullshit. That kind of can
we're here
can
for the party
take, you know, take center stage
for sure.
Yeah, but it's
you have mm-hmm. Yeah, you have so much going on. I feel like in like the past year and especially like the past few months, you know, you've had so many releases, you've been very prolific. I would love to hop straight into it, you know, about sort of a big exhibition coming up. We have peer-to-peer, you know, mentioned it in your intro, but I don't want to sort of skip over the significance of this exhibition. Can you tell us a bit about that, what that's all about, and why, in Sarah's view, is this significant to be working so closely with a museum?
Yes. So peer-to-peer is an exhibition organized by Dr. Tina Rivers Ryan. She's a curator at the Buffalo AKG Art Museum, formerly known as the Albright Knox Gallery. And I just am... I'm over the moon that I was asked to be a part of this. I was, you know, saying to you guys, like, it's one of those instances where people that are sort of my heroes are now feeling like my peers. And that is, that's one of those moments that you sort of work for a long time in life, or what can feel like a very long time. And that's kind of what you're pointing yourself at, right? Is you're going, I'm grinding and I'm doing the work because I want to get there, you know? And I wasn't always there. Like it took a lot of effort and a lot of like personal development of my own artistic voice, my own artistic potency to be at this place. And peer-to-peer is really exciting. You know, listen, like there's a lot of firsts. There's a lot of firsts in this space. But I trust, you know, Tina's guidance as an expert in the field of digital art, that this is the first survey of leading artists working with the blockchain at an American museum. I believe there was a museum in Austria that did a similar show maybe a year or so ago. And Francisco Carolinum, I think, was the museum. But this is sort of a watershed moment. I almost picture it as it's like this tidal wave, right? That was 2021, that was the hype, that was the like, oh my God, NFTs, 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 what are we gonna do? The sky is falling, NFTs. And as that hype has just receded and that tide has gone out sort of slowly all through this year, you know, with the market, and a lot of the financial speculation aspect of it all has lessened, at least in the sense of like what everyone thinks this is all about. It's revealing that artists are still using this technology, artists are still pushing this technology forward, and that we're actually at this moment where, because some of the more grotesque aspects are diminished, institutions, cultural institutions that I personally value, are beginning to value us. I think.
Can we dig into that for a second too? Because I think, you know, I and for people listening, for a bit of context, like Sarah is somebody, since she's been single digits, I believe, has really been like fighting for the right to make work digitally. And nice. You know, I think like a lot of your story involves feeling very much on the fringes of the art community, right? Definitely the art market.
When is stuff art?
And really sort of like working to carve out your own space. I guess I wonder, you know, I imagine that there's a relationship then between an institution like a museum and an artist who has been through this experience subjectively. Can you sort of tell me about that? Because I mm-hmm. for myself, I imagine that like there are moments where I'm like, ah, well, screw the movie theaters, you know what I mean? I wonder sort of what that journey has been like,
yeah.
has been
oh,
like for
Dan.
You as an artist.
Yes, we all feel that way. And there's a lot of voices in the space that are very anti-gatekeeper. Everything is anti-gatekeeper, right? And anything or anyone who is in a position to say yes this, no that is considered a gatekeeper, right? And I've always sort of taken issue, not with the term itself, just with such a broad definition of that term, right? That I think that if we deny the ability to qualify art, the ability to curate truly, like what curation is, we lose something pretty significant. Like, I think that a lot of that maybe comes from folks maybe not really understanding what the actual job of curator is. It's not just keeping people out. You know, as I said, that like this has been a journey for me. Like Jason pointing out that I joined Super Rare in April of 2019, right? I'd been making at that point, I'd been a working artist doing digital art since like 2012. So that's, what's math, 7 years? Like, you know, I'd really developed my craft at that point. And I was pretty confident at that point in my ability to show work that was uniquely mine. And I wouldn't say that was always the case. That took time to develop that. And, you know, Jason saying that like, I actually think I was pretty fortunate that first year on Super Rare. Like, I felt like I sold pretty regularly, but it was not common for any of us to like sell every piece, sell every work, you know. It was just very different back then. And why I'm referencing that, and I've told Jason this, that Jason has, you know, people respect his opinion. People respect his eye for art and his background in art.
If you say so.
So him, you know, putting his money where his mouth is, buying like four or five pieces of mine and then telling everyone, hey, I just bought these four or five pieces. Like, y'all are crazy that you're not like buying this person's work. I've that basically kicked off this snowball that has led me to this moment, that has led me to this space of sort of respect that I find myself in that I did not always have. And I offer that up because, right, I really did have to struggle through many years of like, this was the inspiration for a recent collection I made called Jackie Rex that's inspired by the story of Jacob. And I think a lot, I've always loved the story of Jacob wrestling the angel. And over the years, that's come to very specifically mean to me, you know, what it is to be an artist. I said that to my therapist this week of like, nobody wants their child to be an artist. Like, this was not sanctioned. This career path was not sanctioned in any way, shape, or form for me. And yet my entire life, I've been wrestling that angel and I've been saying, I will not let go of you until you bless me. I demand it. Like, I will not let go. And I guess I'm offering this story up and kind of letting it weave this way because in this market, which is so punishing, this bear market, that the past year, watching artists kind of, I think, get hit worse than anyone, because especially a lot of folks who really thought that a new pathway was opening up for them, and now they've had to, you know, reckon with the fact that just because we have this new technology that helps us validate digital art editions does not mean we necessarily have a wide collector base for it yet. Like, it's that's going to take time. All of us who started getting into this, you know, us nerds who were into this before the hype cycle, I didn't expect it to kick off so quickly. It's COVID. Like, that's why it kicked off so quickly. That's why this like wave of excitement came in from collectors and
exactly.
Investor types looking to, you know, make some money. I still am bullish on the culture and bullish on this sense of like, this has all been, it's like two steps forward, one step back. That's what we've done here. Mm. And I feel how artists are hurting. I have these conversations and I have such empathy for it because I've been there, right? Like, I've been there a lot. I also, like you, Dan, like, I've also worked in the entertainment industry. So, y'all, I'm traumatized. Like, it's like traumatic. It's really a traumatic to be an artist. Like, you really, that is what it is. You are wrestling this angel. You're wrestling something that is bigger than you, that is stronger than you. And it takes a true sense of like deep inner knowing to go, this is my calling and I will not let go of it until I receive my blessing. And so here we are. I'm working
for
with
people
this
listening
museum.
To you know, definitely check out Sarah's collection, Jackie Rex. It was just dropped on Nifty Gateway, I believe it probably 4 weeks ago. Stunning pieces, and watching them even in this, in reference to this conversation, you know, it makes total sense sort of where this came from. I would sort of also love to chat like sort of before NFTs a bit and sort of like your work in GIFs. Mm-hmm. Because I think that there's something there, and I don't know, I'm just going to sort of throw it out. I feel like they're like, that you're the type of person who deals with sort of like these non-question questions pretty well.
Throw it at me.
But I'm wondering sort of about the connection between GIFs and icons, right? And sort of like if GIFs are sort of like the modern day version of an icon. Because your work, I mean, you use the word potent early, and to me, like a lot of your works are so, they are mimetic, right? Like, it's like, they are so condensed, I feel like, into sort of
sort of speaking volumes, but in these very compact GIFs. I mean, JPEGs, images. I wonder if that's something that you've considered or think about.
Oh yeah! Wow, I love how you put that. And I think that the answer is yes and no, right? I think that I very much, as an artist, am like my little tingly sensors are going off when you say that GIF as icon. Absolutely. In the case of my work, I think that is very much true, and that's very much how I'm approaching it. I also think GIF is a term, just like NFT, that is a completely blank container, right? Like that a GIF, just like an NFT, does not imply content whatsoever. It simply implies the containment of content.
The package.
Yeah. The delivery method, basically. And to that end, because there are certain aspects of the GIFs I've made that have come to be very associated with GIFs, such as they loop, such as they're very short, such as, they're very bright and vibrant, internet referential. None of those things have to be true about a GIF. Like, a GIF can be minutes long. It would be enormous, but it could be minutes long. A GIF doesn't, I know plenty of GIFs that don't loop. A lot of reaction GIFs, for example, don't loop.
Infinite possibilities.
To dive in to like what you're saying is, yeah, I think what I always liked about the format of GIF, I mean, I made my first GIF, I think, when I was like 10 for my GeoCities website, like I've been working with GIF for a little,
so cool.
little while now.
So geeky, cool.
It's so geeky. I know. But yeah, like I love the internet and the internet loves me.
Into the
it's
future.
It's what you said.
Internet.
It's mimetic. It shares something with the notion of memes, mimesis at its core being mimicry, being the way behavior travels is viral, right? Like that GM is a perfect example of that, of like all it takes is one of us little primates doing something silly and the other primates
of the
see
space,
it. Yeah. And they're like, oh, that's fun. And then they start doing it too. And suddenly it's everywhere. And suddenly it's language, right? GIF, I think, is a form of language. Like, specifically the way we share GIFs on Twitter, though I know there's some debate around apparently only people born before a certain moment, I guess, do that. I guess that's cringe now to share GIFs, but whatever. GIFs till I die. That like a lot of the ways GIFs get shared, it is a form of language expression. And so when you get into like GIFs that are art, I think that's still true, right? I think that they're the sacred and the profane all rolled up into one little glitchy, twitchy ball. Yeah, and I love that they have infinite duration too. It's Dan, I'm sure you know, like when you submit to like film festivals and things like that are sort of more on the cinema end of things, they always ask you duration. Like, that's important. If you're making a documentary, you need people to know this is an hour and a half long. That's, you can sit in the theater long enough without having to go to the bathroom, some people can, I couldn't, but still, I digress. But for me, on duration, I always put infinite. And then they're always like, oh, God, this one.
Sarah
oh, Jesus.
Zucker again.
God, infinite duration. Great. Or variable. That's usually anymore because I often work with, I don't always work with GIF. A lot of times I do video, especially if I want it. If it's important to me for it to not be overly compressed, I work with video. And I really personally find the two largely interchangeable. But when I am working with video and I have to be asked for duration, usually the video files I prepare for my collectors are the loop, which might be 3 seconds. And I put it there 10 times just because internet web like video players have a skip. And I'm sure every artist listening to this right now is like, their asshole is clenching because it's like, oh, the skip. Why does it skip? Like, it's supposed to loop. Why does it skip? And like, so I that's my way of getting around that is I just put the loop like as many times as I can. I usually aim for somewhere around 30 to 36 seconds. and 36 because it's a sacred number, and because I really do get sort of granular and weird about things like that. I like love that kind of stuff. Little just like little witchy magical touches. But yeah, I'm like, this 36 seconds though already is the loop, you know, 10 times. So it's meant to just be played for as long as you want to look at it.
Mm. Yeah, Bailey, I'm curious sort of like if sort of those mimetic qualities, or sort of like what I'm trying in a roundabout way to describe sort of what I love and admire about Sarah's work, if that's something that you also saw in collecting it when you did.
Yeah. I mean, I've on the record as saying that memes might be the most important art of this generation. Of course, I've also said that digital art's the most important art of this generation. At some point, someone's going to call me out that I keep calling everything the most important art of this generation. But I do think that memes in particular went under the radar for a really long time because people think of it as like cast-off culture, like not as being important culture. I mean, one of the things that I think's unique and interesting about Sarah's work that I'll try to phrase more as a question than a comment is that she may be the only artist I know whose work gets 6.9 billion views by everybody in the world on Giphy, who also ends up in a major museum. And at least, and this is where I'll put it as a question, in my opinion, there's not a dramatic shift in the content, right? So, like, those are two different audiences in my mind, right? 6.9 billion people that are just pretty much everyone. Everyone looks at Giphy. And then the people that I wish everyone went to art museums, but if we're honest with ourselves, not everyone has access and not everyone goes. And I think sometimes artists think, like, I'm going to do my, like, intellectual work for the art museum and, like, you know, absolutely, my silly work for Giphy. From my perspective, the core of your work is the same across those different audiences. But I'm curious, do you think of it like, I'm going to make different work for this audience or for that audience? Or do you feel like there is sort of a core that carries over?
Oh, Jason, this is why you're one of my faves. Is like, I've no one's ever like asked me that, and like, yes, that's intentional, and that's it's intentional that my work is high low is like how I would describe it. It's highbrow low brow. Absolutely. At the same time, and that is by design. It's actually very inspired by, I would say, probably one of the most influential like creative people in my life was Kurt Vonnegut. And I would say his writing is exactly that, right? I read Kurt Vonnegut. I read Cat's Cradle for the first time when I was 11 years old. And I was perfectly able to read it. And like, it blew my mind as an 11 year old. I was like, oh my God, there's this whole world of thinking in this way that is so weird and out there, and what is time and what is reality, and people also are so funny, and like that there's so much like poo-poo humor also, like where you're like, somehow it's so highbrow and then there's like a fart joke, you know? And to me, it's like, look at anything that stood the test of time. Look at Shakespeare's full of poop jokes. Like, not that I'm trying to compare myself to Shakespeare, but my point is that
lots of base humor. Definitely.
Yeah, it's that like, I feel that joy and humor and silliness are some of the most powerful tools we have at our disposal, especially in times of crisis, especially in times of intense societal challenge, which I think we're in right now. And, you know, it's caused, kind of what you were saying earlier, Dan, of like, I think for a long time, especially before my craft was sort of more refined, it caused my work to be tossed aside or looked over and seen as just sort of internet dross, you know, and maybe it was just internet dross at that time. But I really pride myself on my ability at this point to speak to like the inner child and the outer adult at the same time, and bring that out in people and like delight them in that way, because I don't know, maybe it's that I'm like secure in my intelligence, like I'm an educated person, and I think I figured out pretty early on in my education that things that are like overly highfalutin and overly intellectualized are just phony. Like, it's just feels so phony to me. Like, it's just people trying
Absolutely.
To be seen exactly. as smart. Cool. And I don't
you guys are cool.
need people to
it's
see me as
smart.
It's
also a metric that you can't necessarily win, right? Like, if you're trying to do the smartest thing or be objectively correct in your art, then it will inevitably be bad, right? Mm.
If not bad,
it's a metric
just boring.
That is, sure, exactly. Which I would, I guess, equate with badness. But yeah, absolutely. It's not a metric that necessarily can apply to an art practice.
Right.
I do wonder also, though, you know, talking about sort of your intellectual confidence and pairing that with your comments about how hard it is for artists right now today. One of the things that'd be cool to get you to talk about a little bit, you're one of the most vocal collectors I know, not in the sense of I got, and we love Tyler Hobbs, not in the sense of I got my Tyler Hobbs or I got my X copy or the like the check the boxes that shows that you have wealth or that you can collect the people everyone else knows, but in that you have enough confidence to go out and collect art because you love it and you seem to not give a shit what anyone else thinks about, you know, other than you want them to enjoy it the way you enjoy it, but like you're not trying to follow the bingo card of like checking off all the artists that everyone else has. How do you, so A, you know, how do you think about your own collecting and am I right in that? And then B, and maybe this is an unfair question, but I think you share an interest that I have in getting collectors to collect more broadly, a more diverse group of artists. How do we think about helping people, and I don't know, maybe this sounds condescending, but I think in building the confidence to be able to collect art that they love or that they find interesting and isn't just necessarily the most popular. You know, is that even a fair statement?
Oh, I think that's such a fair statement. And it's one of the things I think that's been so brutalizing for artists this past year is watching a lot of the collectors in the space hedge their bets and just double down on the same people and same things, you know, regardless of artistic quality there, you know. And so what I would say to collectors I'm as ardent a collector of art NFT editions as I am a creator of art NFT editions. In my case, I'm an artist, right? And I have a very strong aesthetic sensibility that I trust completely. It's never steered me wrong. And I know a lot about art and about art making because I've been a working artist for my entire adult life. That also makes it so that I'm not worried typically about the pitfalls of collecting, which is often like if you collectors, I think, worry they're buying something derivative and they don't know if it's derivative or not. And that's actually a really good concern to have. I think you're actually a smart, good collector if you recognize you don't know enough about things to know if you are collecting from the person who originated that idea and is originating that style of artwork, or if you're collecting from a copycat. Because the second something becomes popular, copycats come out of the woodwork. And so what I would say to collectors, and this brings to mind, actually, I was just did a little curated NFT launch with a collector of mine who goes by Super Pot Secret. His name is Shaheen. He's awesome. And he was telling me he got into traditional, like physical object-based art collecting well before he got into NFTs through this platform, Avant Art, which is where we released the work. And I thought it was so interesting what he was saying was sort of like, you know, it's like if you're seeing stuff that excites you, like you can trust that. You can trust that feeling. Mm. It's kind of like the feeling of being in love or being attracted to a person. It's yeah, you feel it. Like it's a warmth you feel in you where you're like, ooh, ooh, ooh. Like I love that. That's exciting to me. And then you can take that feeling and then what's great is you do have, like, Avant Art is a great platform for that, that it helps educate collectors. It's pointing them towards, here's why you're excited about this artist and here's why we're presenting them to you. And it really, I think that's been why it's been so successful, is it's kind of onboarded a new generation of young art collectors by speaking their language. And the way that relates to NFTs is that, you know, this is all still so nascent, but there are people who've emerged in the space, you know, like Jason, myself, Dan, you know, like like there are many of us, and you know, I flatter us to say that, of course, but I also am very I believe in my ability to find what's good. I'm a truffle pig. Like I know when I smell the good stuff, you know? And so and so that's what I say to collectors is like, instead of, if what you're really excited about is art collecting, and this isn't just an investment strategy, which if it's just an investment strategy, any guide to investing would tell you there are better things to invest in. Like you really, really should only collect art if you love art, because yes, you can make a lot of money, but just go, baby, just go buy an index fund. Like, you know, like don't gamble
some
on
real
art.
Estate if you must.
Right. Like, it's, you know, so it's to say that's what would be my mandate to collectors, which is look at the folks in the space who are, you know, genuine about this, and look to artists, look to the artists who collect. I feel like I've been shouting that from the rooftops for years, because A, artists tend to not have as much money to throw around as these big collectors. So if we're spending our money on something, you know, we love it, you know?
They're nice.
And that's, you know, look at artists you respect, I should say. Not artists are not a monolith. They encompass a wide range of people and personality types, but I should say, look, if there's an artist you really like and you feel like, hey, I can't really afford that person's work, but oh, he or she is always collecting and is sharing, you know, these other artists who they're sort of like I really do. I view my collection as like I'm vouching for the people I collect. Jason, just like you vouched for me. And that made a huge difference in my career that continues to snowball and like build to this day. And so it's worth tuning in to what people are collecting that's not just the same stuff over and
they're
over
attracted
again.
To dank places
to the other side of that, I guess. You know, I am curious, being the person who's been in this space, who's been a working artist in this particular I'd say genre that's sort of finding its own name or whatever, for so long, and being the person who has maybe been sitting on their therapist's couch being like, these gifts are going to be something, you know, very Cassandra-esque, like,
that's
I wonder
good.
And also being the person who is a Jeopardy champion, you know, I guess I'm really curious as to like what alchemy you've found that works best for you, that centers you in all of that, in sort of that has led you to speak with the confidence that I hear you speaking with today, that I met you with. Like, when you sit here and you say, I know how to do my work, and I know how to do it well, and I know what great work looks like. You know, we can recognize that there are probably younger artists listening who aren't there yet, can't say those words yet with confidence. And I'm wondering for yourself how you found that.
Oh, that is such a great question. And
because we need more of that. I think especially Sarah's, like, we need this, like, artists sitting us down and being like, no, I know something. I know what's up, actually. I'm not asking for you to buy my work, coming and begging, but, like, this is great shit, whether you get it or not, you know?
I think there is undeniably an innate aspect of it, like, that I just was born this person that I am and have managed to not let the world grind me down. I think a podcast I quite like posited this notion, and I've been chewing on it ever since, that you don't it's rare that you meet adult women who are super playful, and it's because it is just much fucking harder to be a person with a female body on this planet and in this society. And I can certainly attest to that. And I think that there's a lot about me being the way that I am that just from my youngest days, I sort of defied that. I defied the elements of culture and the elements of maybe where I grew up and what I experienced that would have snuffed out my joy. And again, that's just an innate thing in me that at every turn, every time I was sort of told I was too exuberant, told I was too talkative, told that girls shouldn't be know-it-alls. And I went, well, too bad, I am. I am one. Too bad. And again, that's like not that's unfortunately not actionable advice. It's not actionable advice to say I was born this way. But what the advice is in that is each of us is born with a temperament, and each of us has an innate temperament, and you have to have honest conversations with yourself about your temperament. And in the words of the great Kim Cattrall, like, I don't want to be in a situation for even an hour where I'm not enjoying myself. So be honest with
the
yourself.
High-low right
yeah.
Here.
Be honest with yourself about your temperament. And for me, it's something where I love people. Like, I love this. Gabbing with you guys, this is the highlight of my week. I feel very overwhelmed in a room with 500 people, especially if all 500 of them are trying to come talk to me. So I know that about myself. I know I'm an extrovert with that limitation, that I'm an extrovert who prefers intimate conversation to mass participation. So, you know, and that's okay. And you're allowed to be the way you are, and you're allowed to say, oh, I'm a little different. I'm a little divergent from what the norm seems to be, or what people perform as the norm. We're all different. We're all special, unique little flowers.
I wonder if this is a little bit, maybe this is a stretch of the superpower of being a weirdo, right? Once you realize that your odds of fitting in are next to like zero, then you stop trying to do that and you just do what you really like and you have confidence in what you like because you haven't grown up trying to like what other people like because that wasn't going to be your path, right? So the freedom of being a weirdo on some level.
Oh, 100%. I started identifying as weird, I think, when I was like 5 years old. Proudly, it was cool to be weird in elementary school. It was middle school where all the girls were like, you're weird. And then I was like, wait, you used to like me because I was weird. What do you mean that's bad now? Well, this sucks. But to speak further to your point, Dan, is I guess where the confidence in it comes from is also just putting in the time. And I always catch myself I'm not that old. I catch myself talking about myself like I'm an ancient, like, wizened crone. I'm really not yet, but I have been doing this, you know, for a while. And it's one of those pieces of advice. Like, I got this piece of advice when I was, you know, in my early 20s and I was getting an MFA. And it's very commonly given to people at that age, to young artists, which is you need to put in 10,000 hours. You need to put in 10,000 hours in order to be a master of your craft. And there's a great This American Life episode where Ira Glass kind of expounds on that and also talks about how you have to be willing to be shitty at what you do in order to earn being good at what you do. And that's why
exactly.
I speak so openly about that, because people can look. A lot of my work is online. I've hidden some of it, but I've left most of it up from like years ago. And you can really see my trajectory. You can see that I started
that?
Just like remixing other stuff, you know. And at this point in my practice, I really create everything, mostly everything, 95% I create completely like in studio myself. And it's not to say I think there's great assemblage and collage work out there. It's not a knock on remix work. It's just to say that, like, I think it's great for young artists or for people trying to figure stuff out to just kind of play around with other people's stuff. Now, do I think you should necessarily monetize that work? That's a completely different question, right? And I think that that's what I see a lot of with young artists getting into this, editioning their work in a way that wasn't available to me back then when I was in their place, where I kind of want to go, it's not that you can't, it's not certainly not my place to tell anyone what they can and can't do, but listen to the feedback loop of what the world is giving back to you, that maybe your work isn't mature yet, maybe your voice isn't mature yet, and maybe that's why you're not finding great success with it. And the message is not quit. The message is not give it up, kid. The message is keep going. Keep going. Go deeper. Make it deeper. Make it more. Make it more you. Stop trying to do what other people are doing and make it more you. And that's the only way. Sorry, there's no shortcut. Like, it's that.
I understand.
Sarah Zucker, I love chatting with you. I feel like these conversations always very much recenter myself. Oh, wait. Art Gnome, did you hear that?
I think I heard something. I think it might be time for 22 questions. This is the segment where we rapid
first,
fire. Oh, sorry. Oh, we have a pre-roll.
We got a pre-roll, Bailey.
We've got a pre-roll.
Are your NFTs built to last? Sadly, the truth is probably not. About 40% of NFTs store the images and the artwork and the metadata all off-chain on private servers owned by the marketplaces. So when the marketplaces go under, poof, there goes the value of your NFT. And less than 10% of NFTs actually store all the files on-chain, and that's because it's really, really expensive. That leaves 50% of NFTs which use IPFS. The great news is, for your IPFS NFTs, as long as you create a local backup, you can always restore your NFTs in the future. Go to clubnft.com and create a free backup today.
This episode of The Dankness. Bailey, you want to introduce this segment? I know it's your favorite.
It is. I jumped the gun earlier because I love it so much. Now it is officially time for 22 questions. This is the time when we ask rapid-fire questions from all walks of life to try to get to the unique viewpoints and little tidbits about our guests' lives that don't normally get asked or exposed in the everyday interview. Very excited for Sarah's answers today. I don't know, Dan, I don't know who went first last time, but maybe we'll have you kick it off with question numero uno.
Question number one, Miss Sarah Zucker, what did you eat for breakfast this morning?
I made myself a glorious plate of fried eggs over easy with avocado and air-fried tempeh.
Dank.
I'm like literally eating popcorn right now as my breakfast. That's so impressive.
I'm a little fancy.
I think I had coffee.
That's
I'm jealous.
Good.
Could you please, Sarah, describe the state of your bed right now?
It is made with a little souvenir pillow filled with pine needles from the Catskills.
No way. Wait, are you one of these, like, are you like, you wake up and you make your bed right away, like military corners and all of that?
Yeah, and I didn't. I'm like in my studio right now, and my studio's a mess, but yeah, I like to keep my house like, I'm kind of like a big Martha Stewart fan. I like domestic engineering. Like, I do.
I did not know this.
Yeah.
I can't wait to visit your place one day. do you prefer a pencil or a pen? And do you have a preferred brand?
I have a very strong preference for pen only. I loathe pencil. I break pen. I write incredibly hard. Like, I always have. I inscribe the paper. And my favorite kind of pen is a Pilot G2. I've been using them for like 15 years.
I love G2s. They're the perfect amount of thickness.
Yep.
Yeah.
They're the best.
Yep. For sure.
I need to get in on this G2 action. I've been stuck with pencils my whole life. how old were you when you received your first computer?
I actually, my family had a computer when I was born. And I was thinking about this recently. I learned to type at the same time I learned to write, which is unusual for someone my age. And I think it's why my handwriting is absolute chicken scratch.
Question number five is, who is your favorite philosopher or thinker?
Off the top of my head, I'm going to say Sartre, just because lately I've really been feeling that hell is other people.
Oh, wow.
Really, it's been not feeling Kim Cattrall.
And Kim Cattrall.
If you say so.
She really believes that hell is other people, specifically her castmates on Sex and the City.
Next question, very important. Maybe a little personal. Foosball, air hockey, mini golf, or ping pong? I believe it's a combo question. So first question, foosball or air hockey. Second question, mini golf or ping pong?
Definitely foosball. Love a foosball. Love the, how, like, ooh, I love it. I love clicking on that little ball, right? And what's the next one? Mini golf versus, what's my other option? Ping pong? Mini golf. Ping pong is too stressful. I don't like any activity where there are balls flying at my face.
Please calm down.
What's your preferred pizza topping? And what's your least preferred pizza topping?
Oh, I have not been able to eat pizza for years because it like wants to murder me. I'm
cool.
A purist. Actually, no, I'm going to say, if not just like a plain cheese pizza, I would say my favorite pizza topping, if I could eat pizza, is onions, like just white onions. Just put them all up on there. Least favorite pizza topping. I mean, off the top of my head, I'm going to say like anchovies. Don't people put that on pizza? Fish and cheese. That's unholy.
Makes no sense.
Exactly.
So I have an important follow-up. Caramelized onions, or you want like those kind of bitey, like uncooked almost?
Just like
onions.
Some raw, just like
both. I love a stinker. I love an aromatic vegetable. They don't love me back so much anymore, but I love them. Can't get enough. And anyway, love them.
Woman after my own heart.
This is why everyone's glad now that they only engage with me on the internet, because I just told them all like onions and garlic.
Love onions and garlic. And
we don't yet have smell-o-vision. Yeah.
So this one, I think our last guest had to pass on it because they wanted time to think about it, but it is kind of a deep question. So who in the world would you like to meet but haven't?
Oh my God, that's such a good question. I'm gonna just go through a Rolodex in my head. This is like not deep, but the first person who comes to mind is Kate Blanchett. I think she's fabulous.
She is so fab. Honestly, mine was Britney Spears, Sarah. So
yeah. Okay. Cool.
You know, we're kindred spirits there.
I think that I'm also like I have like a huge crush on Kate Blanchett. So I was like, cool. Yeah, I'm not that deep actually. Like, I really just like, oh, Kate Blanchett.
Next question is, what's one vice that you'll openly admit?
Oh, one vice that I'll openly admit. That's hard, because how do you define a vice, right? Like, I try really to, like, live my life without shame, you know? So it's like anything I do, I'm like, yeah, this is fine. But I guess it's like, it's no secret I'm kind of a pothead, you know? Like, so I think that might be traditionally considered a vice. Like, I don't define it that way, and I'm in a very nice place with it in my life at this point, and it gives me a lot of joy, so.
You are speaking on the dankness.
Right, I am now, on so. The dankness, right. Oh, yeah, gotta keep it dank. Right.
Well, it's dank.
This is a no judgment zone.
Yeah.
And an often overlooked aspect of your personality is?
An often overlooked aspect of my personality. Oh, that's a hard one.
Oh,
I don't know.
What don't people know about you that you're like, why doesn't anyone know that I'm funny? You know?
Yeah. I mean,
what is
yeah,
that
well,
thing?
It's, I guess it's, you know what's why it's stumping me is because I feel like when I'm on the internet, I'm being really myself. Like, I'm being really pretty open about how I really am and showing how I really am. And so all my internet friends are getting like the real me and like getting it. So I'll answer that by saying, in person, I think it's exactly that, Dan. I have had that experience my entire life where people look at like the package of what this is and they decide in their heads, I'm like a very different type of person. And they think I'm like, like they have blonde girl trauma, right? So they think I'm mean. They assume I'm a bitch and they don't realize that it's like, oh, I'm such a goofy goober. Like, you can't always go into every situation with like a clown nose on honking a horn, right? So it's like when I'm just being normal, people are like, I don't know about her, you know? So it's that. I think sometimes people don't get that, as Jason said, I am a weirdo. Like, definitely live on the continuum between Miss Piggy and Gonzo. Like, that's where I exist. So
I love that. If you had to choose one, what would you say is your favorite era of art?
Oh, I'm off the top of my head, of course, I could say many, but the one I've just continually dive into is like the 1920s and German expressionism specifically. And it's always grabbed me, and it's so weird. We're obviously now in the 2020s, so I think there's maybe just a certain like time travel thing I have with that era where I relate to those people. I relate to how they were thinking. I relate to their sense of like, oh my God, the world is modernizing. Everything's changing so rapidly. What are we going to do? We're going to paint crazy ass paintings is what we're going to do. We are going to make things that look like feelings. And I like to make things that look like feelings. So, yeah, the 1920s for sure.
Oh, nice. Always wanted to curate a digital expressionism show. And I think your work fits like clearly like right in there. So I can see that connection for sure. Let's see. If you could change just one thing about your neighborhood, what would it be, Sarah?
Your IRL neighborhood,
oh,
not your metaverse
that's
neighborhood.
That's hard. The thing I'm going to say is really... It has layers to it. It's that there are a lot of big scary dogs in yards, and I love dogs. I love them. Love dogs. I'm a little scared of big dogs. Like if they're barking at me, and I'm not sure how they're like being contained, you know. And I love to walk. I walk. It's walking is like how I ground myself. I walk 3 miles every day. Like you gotta touch grass, guys, you know? So that's my one complaint is I get very, in my poor little sensitive nervous system just completely flips out when a dog is running at me and barking.
How rare. What's one piece of art that you'd like to own but don't?
It's funny
or
you
by
ask
an
that.
Artist.
Yeah, it's funny you ask that. I've recently been indulging in like, I found this website called Live Auctioneers that lets you participate in art auctions. Not Christie's, Sotheby's, but like, you know, there are a lot of auction houses out there that are kind of like down the chain, so to speak. And I just bought my first piece of like IRL art through one of these auctions. By this artist, Pedro Friedberg. He's a Mexican artist, and his work is so psychedelic and cool. It's like these, like, I almost imagine them being like DMT realms. Like, I've never done DMT, but based on what people have explained that as, that's what they look. They're like these psychedelic cathedrals. There's like Jewish mysticism in there. I can't get enough of them. And he has pieces that are like really, I bought a very small one, but he has like bigger works that I would love to own.
Far out.
Very cool.
I'm gonna go off script because we didn't really talk much about this and you triggered my thoughts on it. Instead of asking the question that's loaded up for me,
I love when Bailey goes rogue.
Yeah, I'm going rogue.
Embracing myself.
When was your first psychedelic experience?
My first psychedelic experience I did shrooms first when I was, I guess I was 20. It was the summer after my junior year of college. And I loved my roommate that year. I lived with three guys that year. I went to Northwestern and I lived off campus in Evanston. And and my roommate Rob and my very dear childhood friend Alan was visiting, and we all, you know, ate these mushrooms. And like, if people don't know, like Evanston, Illinois is right on Lake Michigan, and it was the summer. So we went out to the lake, and there are all these painted rocks. Like, people paint all these rocks that are on the lake, and they were so colorful. And it just was like this, it was just the moment where I knew, I was like, this is who I am. Like, I'm meant to do this. Like, I am called to do this. Like, I'm Bugs Bunny right now. And like, love that it just is like bringing me so out of all my insecurities about my body, about my selfhood. It's like putting me into this like space of just like transcending time. And it made me so playful. Like, I remember, you know, and it wasn't like a hero's, it was a nice amount where I was definitely potent, but it wasn't like too potent. And we were coming back to our apartment, and there was like a tour group, you know, of like young, of like teenagers touring the campus. And there was this clock tower on campus, and I saw this tour group, and I went up to them, and I went, that's where the president of the university lives. I know, he's my daddy. And I was like, for some reason, like, just delighting in telling these 17-year-olds like that the president of the university lived at the top of the clock tower, and that he was my daddy. He was my papa. And like, and then I was like. And then we went back to my apartment, and we were moving out like the next week, and our walls were painted blue, and we had to, our landlord said we had to paint them back to white before we moved. So we knew, we had planned like, oh, we're going to have to paint the walls white. So I had the thought of getting all this paint and markers and everything, and we just went to town on the walls. And I was just like scream laughing, finger painting. I painted this enormous demented face with sharp teeth and like blood, like you know, very much like my work now. Like this like totally demented vision, just like cackling the entire wall. I made a mural basically on mushrooms with my hands. These paintings that were like these two like Victorian women, and I wrote dumb bitch one and dumb bitch two over them, and was just laughing and laughing and laughing. And like, I have this, I also like, I had a camcorder at the time, and I have this all on videotape, which you should not do when you're on psychedelics, but I think it's like it might be on YouTube, I think, from like back then, because it just was like, I don't know, like anyone, like there's apprehension, right? Like, I was like a good kid. I was like, oh, I don't know, like these psychedelics, I don't know how this is going to go. And then it was like discovering like, holy shit, I'm Timothy Leary. Like, I didn't realize like I'm actually meant to be like a trickster spirit. And it was life changing. And
someday someone's going to uncover the hidden Evanston Zucker fresco.
Right? I like, that's my dream, is one day maybe I could buy that building, because we had to paint over it, which one of my favorite things to draw with is just a fat Sharpie marker. I still to this day do a lot of my drawings and a lot of my sketch work I do with a Sharpie, because it's the easiest way for me to translate to the video painter, because it's so like the lines are so thick on the video painter. And so I also drew all over one wall with Sharpie. And I then learned you cannot paint over Sharpie. Like, we had to spackle that wall in order to cover these insane things I wrote the wall.
Like Sarah's like Goya moment.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah. But that's exactly.
Find the barn, rip the doors down. Exactly. There are some murals underneath.
Exactly.
That paint.
If I keep going with my art career, like, people might actually be quite vested in like discovering these early works of mine.
Oh, wow. What, the next question, we'll see where this takes us. What website would you say has made the most profound impact on your life?
Okay, without overthinking it, I'm going to say eBay. I got really into eBay when I was 10, and which I don't think was like allowed. I probably, like most websites are supposed to be at least 13.
Not.
But yeah. I had a thriving, like, I love treasures and I love buying them. I love collecting them. I love selling them. Like, I love just like, I keep threatening my wife that I'm like, I'm going to become an antiques dealer. Like, I think that I just am going to. She's like, yeah, you probably are. She's like, because good. I want some of these things to leave our house also. And yeah. And when I was 10, I just got super into acquiring like little knickknacks and treasures and figuring out like what they were. Like, I've watched probably every episode of Antiques Roadshow since it debuted in 1997. And so, and I would have I was always getting checks for like $5 in the mail, and I'd give them to my parents and sign them and be like, give me my $5, you know, because I didn't have a bank account. And they eventually were like, what are you doing? Why are you getting checks? You're 11. Why are you getting checks in the mail all the time? Yeah, and like, again, it wasn't like high value stuff, but it was I was flipping things. I was like buying cool things. I was like, I can sell this for more than what I just bought. I got a deal on this, and I'd write these like glowing descriptions of like this treasure, right? And I'd upsell it. And I think about it all the time, how like what I do now, why I think I've been so successful in like being my own art dealer, essentially, is that I just like genuinely have a joy and a passion for that kind of thing.
I got some shit that's
love it,
dick.
Sarah, what is your favorite insect?
Oh, that's a hard one because insects, I intellectually like insects, but in actuality, they're similar to the dogs in the yard. Like, love the doggy, don't so much love it when it's coming at me. And I will jump out of my skeleton when I see any kind of insect. But
no.
What's my favorite kind of insect? I don't know if I've ever really... I guess lightning bugs. Lightning bugs are one of the few where I'm like, cool. Oh, you're a friend. I like you. Yeah, you don't scare
They're
me.
They're pretty magical,
you're,
for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, like, so you're pretty. You glow, just like me. Yeah.
Part two of this question, I think, is going to be easier for you. What is your least favorite insect?
I'm going to say maybe an unusual one, that a moth or a butterfly.
Oh, anything, you hate butterflies.
It, again, intellectually, like cerebrally, I'm like, oh my God, they're gorgeous. They're fascinating. But if a moth exists in the same space as me, I will poop my pants. Like, I will not be okay. Like, it's like, oh God. Oh no. Oh no. For some reason, my body thinks that we're under attack. You know, like, it's the flippity flap. The flippity flap and the...
Too much.
It's too overwhelming.
The moths I get, but Sarah hates butterflies might be the hot take that we advertise this episode with.
Right.
Sarah
and loves raw onions.
And loves onions.
There you go. You guys really went deep on this. You got that... That deep info.
If you have one option. You have one option. You can either time jump into the random future or time jump back to the random past. What do you choose?
I'm going to time jump into the random future, which might surprise people considering how past referential my work is. But I'm going to say that just out of the sense that, like, in the grand course of history, and I think people lose sight of this sometimes because of the news cycle, that there's never been a better time to be alive as a person who has a female body. There's never been a better time to be alive to be a queer person. Like, I don't want to go to the past. Fuck the past. Like, they wouldn't have been so nice to me back then. The only way I'd want to go to the past is if I could also jump into the body of a handsome, straight white man. You know what I mean? And be that in the past.
Who's
and
also then maybe it would a have been, prince.
Right, and then it would have been super duper fun, I'm sure. But if I have to be me in the past, no bueno. That's not going to be a good time for me. So I'll go to the future.
Future. The future.
Great answer.
Speaking of the past, Bailey.
Yeah, worst job ever, Sarah. What's your worst job ever?
Oh, that's an easy one. When I was 17, I worked at TJ Maxx. I worked in the housewares department, which meant that I had to unpack all of the housewares from the big, like, cargo boxes they came in. They came in these giant boxes, with all this weird packing material sprayed with all kinds of chemicals. And I have very sensitive skin, so I just had like a rash the entire time. And it's, you know, TJ Maxx, not such a glamorous place. I did my best.
TJ Maxx rash.
Yeah, TJ Maxx rash. That was my life the summer I was 17. But I made the most of it. I would organize all of the like weird shit that came in, like the, you know, these bottles with peppers, you know, in oil and God only knows what else. And I would make dioramas out of them on the end caps. And that was not appreciated, which might not surprise you to learn that I got a stern talking to about stop trying to make our crap look good. It's supposed to look like garbage. That's kind of our whole thing. TJ Maxx's brand is TJ Maxx. We sell shit. So don't make it look good. Like they were mad at me because I was making it look like it was expensive. And they were like, we're not selling it because people who come here want things that are cheap. So it needs to look
break
cheap.
It, Sarah. Yeah, you just break it and then put it on the shelf.
Right. If you pick it up, your hand should be slimed with nasty ass oil and the you know, towels should look like they're gonna give you scabies. Like that's our brand. Stop trying to mess with it. And so I did.
What was you mentioned Bugs Bunny earlier, but I wonder what your favorite animated series was as a child.
Oh my God. Easy, easy, easy answer. Ren and Stimpy. I lived for Ren and Stimpy, still live for Ren and Stimpy. Like the second I would stay up, you know, it would air on SNICK, and the second I heard that first note of the theme song, it was like someone had given me cocaine. I would like come alive. I had a whole dance. I had a whole routine I would do to that like jaunty, jazzy theme song. And my mom was like telling me this recently that she was like, because it was actually, I knew a lot of kids who weren't allowed to watch Ren and Stimpy. A lot of my friends weren't allowed to watch it. My mom would let me watch it. Yeah, it was. It's very violent. not even violent necessarily in like action. It's like violent in just its energy is so chaotic.
It's very aggro.
It's very aggro. And my mom was telling me this recently. She's like, you didn't know this, but I would cut you off at 2 episodes because if I didn't, you would like smash your brother's head into the wall or something. Like it turned me, like I turned into a cartoon character and I would be like, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go on a delightful violent rampage, you know? So, it worked me into a lather that I just, it was so stimulating. Like and to this day, I think it's a huge influence in my art, just how twisted and demented and beautiful the animation was. And you know, I now as an adult also can hold the cognitive dissonance of like the creator John Kay seems to be not such a great person and has done some bad things. People can Google that for themselves. And you know, you both can't separate the art from the artist, and you can, like, and that's, people struggle with that. I don't struggle with that I still think that show is one of the greatest animated shows, if not one of just greatest any type of show of all time. And
that's an era that isn't talked about too much. Rocko's Modern Life, Ah, Real Monsters, like all those SNICK cartoons. I mean, Rocko, like there are some incredible stories in those episodes.
Oh my God, Rocko's Modern Life was so good. The B-52's theme song, like I continually feel so lucky that I am literally, I think, the perfect age cohort that like Nicktoons came out when I was 5. Like Rugrats came out when I was 5, I think. And all of that happened right when I was in elementary school. And by the time Nicktoons started to get a little insipid, I was already kind of too old for that kind of content anyway. So it's like I just really hit that sweet spot of like, there's this great documentary about Nickelodeon in the 90s. I can't remember what it's called. But because of that documentary, I realized, I think, part of why Nickelodeon was so good. The president of Nickelodeon was a woman. The entire board were women. That people, I did not know that it was all women.
I didn't know that either.
And they were asking themselves, in because prior to that, children's programming had always been, what do we as adults think children need to see? And these women, who many of them were mothers who had their own children, who were basically studying their own children, were going, we need to make content. Let's stop talking down to kids. Like, they figured out, we need to make content that speaks to the pathos of children. Like, it, there was this great story in it about this woman who was the president of Nickelodeon, who's responsible for all of those great shows, for greenlighting all of them, where she was studying her 8-year-old. He came home from school, his shoulders slouched. Like, he was just like, you know, poor little guy, like, having a bad day. And she asked him, like, what's up? And he was like, oh, I have homework, my teacher, that, you know. And she was saying, she was like, people don't give enough credit to the fact that children are just small people, and they have pain, and they have pathos, and then they have these shows that are like, hey kids, like, so patronizing to them, and they are hungry for things that get on their level and things that feel a little naughty. Like, Nicktoons always felt a little naughty because it was like
the HBO for kids. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it was like, right, it was like, oh, those grown-ups, they don't get it, you know? And it's like,
totally,
obviously,
right,
those shows were being made by grown-ups, but it was being made by grown-ups who themselves were still playful, had retained that sense of playfulness, and had not let the play be snuffed out of them by life. And what a gift. What a gift they gave all of us with that.
Love it. Love it. I'm gonna jump a question, because I inserted one technically earlier about the psychedelics. And I like the question after this question better. So I'm going to jump to the question of, what is your ideal afterlife scenario?
Oh, my God. Jason, you're going to give me an existential crisis. I don't know. I mean, I think, to me, if I got to choose, I think reincarnation is the best model, right? Is, I actually have been thinking about this a lot lately. This is like a heady topic I've been chewing on, both just for my life and, but also I think in my art. I've been thinking about how, like, our DNA is really ancient. Like, our DNA has been around for, like, what, 100,000 years? And it keeps reiterating. Every generation, it reiterates. It's the same DNA reiterating, mixing, you know, becoming something new. And, like, I've lately been taking this kind of, like, psychedelic perspective of, like, oh, what I think of as myself is actually my DNA having an experience called Sarah. And it's why I think sometimes I get really, like, I kind of get fussy with people when they put a lot of, like, identity politics stuff on me. I really don't like being put in a box. My feeling is like, hey, you can put me in a box when I'm dead, but don't try to do it any sooner than that. You know what I mean? My DNA is having an experience called Sarah, and I want that to be expansive. And I want to give my DNA a little treat and let it do things it hasn't done before, you know? And I can say that that's true for me. Like, I guess that's why it's been coming up is I've had to really, like, be taking care of myself. My nervous system has been really overloaded with you know, all of this the past 2 years. And it's caused some, like, health stuff for me. And that's, I guess that's where that thought comes from, is this feeling of, like, well, what do you expect? You're asking your DNA to do something it's never done before. It was, you know, my DNA was digging potatoes in like, Eastern Europe for hundreds of years. Like, it doesn't know how to be this kind of person doing this kind of stuff, tapped into the entirety of human intelligence every single day, for better or for worse. Like, that's crazy that I'm asking it to do that. But it's also cool. Like, it's also really cool. And so I frame it that way for myself because I feel like I don't want any of this to end. Like, I want it to keep going. I'm really enjoying the successes I've been having, but I have to get better at handling them, and I have to get better at taking care of myself. So I frame it like that to go, it's okay, little doodle. Like, you're learning. You're having an experience called Sarah that your DNA has never experienced before, and there's a loading period for that. So I think, like, that no ties in nicely to the idea of, like, reincarnation, in the sense that, like, we don't go to some chicken farm in the sky. We don't just cease completely. That energy gets redistributed. and that maybe when it gets redistributed, redistributed, I don't know, that sounded weird to me. When it gets redistributed, that maybe our energy carries something with it, and maybe the next experience we have will like, you know, iterate in a way where it knows how to do things a little bit better.
It's a perfect answer for a podcast called The Dankness.
Yeah, that was, I think, I think we hit 21 questions there, but I really think that's the perfect way to sort of round this out. I love how these questionnaires always sort of find their natural ending. And I think it's beautiful, Sarah, to sort of like sort of think of yourself as a steward of your own contents in a way.
Your legacy. That,
you know, you almost don't even own them. So you kind of can take care of it as much as you want or don't want in order for like the next sort of not Sarah to maybe use it. I think it's it's gorgeous. Sarah Zucker, thank you so much for hanging with us today. For everyone listening, please check out Sarah's work. SarahZucker.com. Check her out on Super Rare. Check her out on Tezos. Follow her on Twitter at The Sarah Show. And especially, I think that this is probably going to be airing before this peer-to-peer exhibition. So be sure to check that out as well. Thank you so much, Sarah. Always, always lovely to see you. And I hope to make it happen again.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys. This was great.
Hi all, it's Benjamin here. I'm a 13-year-old schoolboy from London, fascinated by the world of cryptocurrencies. Last year, I launched my own NFT project called Ringing Bells, and it went viral. As a young person who's grown up in these rapidly changing times, it's extremely important to document the crypto art and digital assets movement, and that's why I'm honoured to be a part of New Here. New Here is both a film and an NFT project by Dan Sickles, which aims to capture the stories within the crypto art movement, featuring some of the greatest minds within the space, such as Tyler Hobbs, G Money, Claire Silver, and Snowfrone. There's three ways you can get involved with the project. The first is to head over to their Twitter and give them a follow. The second is to jump into our Discord, where we have an extremely vibrant community. And the last is to mint a newbie NFT, which you can do so to support the project.
Or at newhere.xyz.
So thank you to our guest, Sarah Zucker. It's been an honor having you join us on The Dankness today. One of the first people that Dan and I thought of when we started this crazy podcast, we were like, who's someone that we both love that we think is like crazy creative and will kind of understand the madness of our vision for this podcast? And we couldn't be happier to have had you as a guest.
Thank you, Sarah. Make sure to check out her work at The Sarah Show on socials. That's at The Sarah Show. And sarahzucker.com, sarahzucker.com.
And big love to Stella with the dank tones, bringing in our sound effects.
Magnificent dank tones, extra dank.
Super dank.
And you can find us on the interwebs at thedankness.xyz. newhere.xyz, and clubnft.com. You can also catch us on our personal accounts at artnome, at artnome, and at dan_sickles, D-A-N, little spacey thing, S-I-C-K-L-E-S.
And without further ado, have a danky, danky day. Stella, take us out.
Blank. Dark and dank.
Hello. No one is available to take your call. Please leave a message after the tone.
I can see how people can get really addicted to this. It makes me feel like anything is possible.
Flood and Stella are audiovisual artists collaborating to make waves in the Dankiverse with their trippy, acid-infused art project called the Danktones. They have been super busy lately, working around the clock to create some mind-bending image composition NFT art that's about to turn heads in the community. They're hitting all the retro music store vibes. The podcast cover art includes stickers, holographics, shrink wrap, and even some redacted sound effects. Yes, you heard that right. This wild duo is bringing back physical media vibes in a big way with this release. But it's not just the medium that's impressive, it's the audio-visual art itself. Flood and Stella's art is truly something special, with bright, bold colors and intricate patterns and zany sound effects that will have you feeling like you're tripping on acid. So if you're a fan of NFT art and you're looking for something a little bit different, definitely check out Flood and Stella's The Danktones Project. Thanks for your time. Have a dank, 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 dank,